Hey, folks, and welcome back to Typology, the show in which we explore the mystery of the human personality through the lens of the Enneagram. I'm Anthony Skinner, producer of the show, and we are happy to have you back for part two of our two-part series with Amy Grant and her manager, Jennifer Cook. In this show, Ian helps Amy move down the road to discovering her type, and one of the ways he does this is by using stances as a process of elimination and then determination as well. So it's a really, really helpful episode. I know you're going to enjoy this part two. Be sure and stick around for the end of the episode where Amy shares a song with us. And hey, don't forget to join our Patreon campaign. You can do so by going to www.patreon.com/typology. That's patreon.com/typology. Select the level at which you'd like to support the show, and you will not only receive our undying love and gratitude, but you're going to get a bunch of great bonus content as well. Even a dollar a month, folks, is a huge, huge help. That's it for me, Anthony Skinner. We're going to rejoin Ian's conversation with Amy Grant and Jennifer Cook. And now here's the host of our show, Ian Cron.
Now, you said something to me, too, that was interesting. That was, as I was listening to you earlier, you said that when you went on a stage, though, where you could tell your own stories, right? Tell me, do you remember what you were saying to me earlier?
I just said I love hearing other people talk. I really
yes,
do.
Right.
And so I don't know what it would be like not having the stage. I've always had the stage, so I've never felt like no one's heard my voice.
Right.
Because it was just handed to me. And so that need to tell my own story is met every time I introduce a song or... Mm. So I've always felt heard, but it's like so I have three older sisters, and when we are all together, I just remember the pattern of my sister Carol is not quite 2 years older than I am.
Right.
And when the four of us are together, unless there's something really specific, Carol and I are mostly listening
mm-hmm.
to Kathy and Mimi.
Right.
And I used to think it was an age thing, but it was just, it wouldn't even be that the subject was that commanding or that powerful or whatever. It was just the stance.
Right. So this sounds like they're in an assertive stance. You're in a withdrawn stance. It's a social style.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, this is where I go. There's so much wiggle room in all of this because I individually wouldn't characterize both of those older sisters as necessarily assertive.
Right. I don't know them, so it, but,
right.
But they're more assertive than you are, let's say.
In that setting, that was just the pattern.
Right.
So it was kind right. of a the pattern.
So you said a couple of other things, and I'm saying this so our people can hear it, and
uh-huh.
and because to help them find their own types, you know.
Yeah, this is very helpful.
Okay.
When you
cool.
talked about stance.
Yes. Right.
Yes.
So stances are fantastic. And I've now started to teach this, the Enneagram, this way. I start with stances mm-hmm. because it's like, I can eliminate six types for you right away.
Yeah.
Are you a withdrawn, assertive, or compliant? If you say compliant, throw out the other six numbers because we're going to zero in on those.
Right.
You know, so, and so you said something on the stage thing, though, before we get off that. The reason I love it, and I've seen you perform live a bunch of times, is there you're free to assert yourself
mm-hmm.
and make your presence known.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And your presence matters there. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So it's very beautiful.
It's my job to show up.
It's your job to show up.
Yeah.
And but it's interesting. Offstage, my experience of you is that's not a compulsion. Like for 3s, 7s, and 8s, they come into a space, you feel it. I mean, they just bring this certain big energy.
Yes.
Right? When a 9 walks
I'm
into a space.
More of a 3.
What's that?
I'm becoming more of a 3.
Yeah, but
yeah.
I mean, yeah. Well, and the thing is, well, you know what? I'll describe maybe in a second what possible tensions there may have been between mm-hmm. the two of you and possible things, because that might actually help us find out if you're for sure a 3. We'll come at it sort of sideways in that. But you said something earlier to me. You said that you have an Airstream, you have a hitch on the back of your car.
Mm-hmm.
And you love to camp, right?
I do.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so you went, I love that you went to Bonnaroo. You've been to, like, what else did we were talking, you just like
Virginia,
to get out.
Virginia, I've always wanted to bike the creeper trail, you know, the rails to trails, and did that 2 summers ago. And, you know, it's my go-to place in my head, even if I don't, even if I can't work it into my schedule. Like I'll go, oh, someday I'm going to go to this place.
Amy, I don't know any other type on the Enneagram who loves nature more than nines. And that's not me just making that up here as a personal opinion. That's widely recognized.
Really? Okay. So, ding, ding, ding. We have a winner. Winner, chicken dinner.
Here's the reason. I'm not saying other types don't love outdoors. You know, sevens love adventures. Eights, you know, I'm not. But nines have a particular affection for the outdoors. If it is 10 degrees outside, my wife will go, you want to go for a walk? And I'm like, I would rather eat glass than go for a walk right now.
Yeah.
She's like, I got to get outside.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? And she'll she'll bundle up, and even the dog doesn't want to go with her, right? And I'm like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And like, she's out there walking and looking at the trees and the sky. Yep. And I think it's this. You are body-centered people. You connect to the world from the gut. And it's like, you said something to me on the way over here in the car. You went, grass in the face, grass in the face, grass in the face. Do you remember this in the car ride over?
Yes, because we were talking about riding.
Yes. And what were you telling me?
I said, when I listen to my children tell stories, they do it from a more narrative perspective, as though they can see themselves in that. I was walking up the stairs and they called my name. I turned around and I had this such and such look on my face.
Right.
And I referenced something that I had written. I said, if I'm the animal running through a field, I don't have an aerial view of myself. Right. My experience is of running is grass in the face, grass in the face.
Yes. I love that story, by the way, because it speaks to this kind of body centeredness and this kind of like in the moment centeredness. And you all have, I think, particularly in nature, this gut world. It's just gut world. It's like, oh, it's like all in the body, gut world. And like, and you guys are action people. So twos, threes, and fours, when they meet the world, it's through the lens of feelings first. When five, sixes, and sevens meet the world, it's through the brain or thinking first, right? Before anything else. If you're an 8, 9, or one, it's all from the gut first. It's like this boom, like, you know, from the hip, you know, and that's what you were describing earlier when it's like, pick up the phone and, you know, you just act. You will act first, not think and feel first. You'll act and then you'll think and feel in the aftermath of acting. And then maybe 5 seconds later, maybe 5 hours later. But your first instinct would be to act first. Does that?
Yes.
Absolutely. Okay. Yeah, 100%.
Now, so you're laughing. What's so funny?
Is this? Just enjoying my inner monologue.
Okay, so you did something in the car ride over too, or when we were out here talking in the parking lot in the car.
Okay.
That I was like, We were talking, and then I was saying something, and you went down like this, and you. Your eyes went to the floor, and you got this sort of far, what I call the sort of the gaze into the middle distance. It's like this sort of, you'd be talking, and suddenly you just like go, and it's almost like a little bit of a zone out. Sometimes I'll see a nine. My wife does it. My daughter does it. I see nines do this all the time. They'll be talking to you, and then they might go. Have you ever had this experience, Jennifer? We're like
a few
engaged,
times.
engaged, and then it's sort of like it gets this fuzzy space place, right? And it's the nine going up into what we call the inner sanctum, and they've gone, they've kind of retreated a little bit up into here, and they're thinking.
Do they ever leave the meeting you're having?
Oh, no.
You're like, wait, we were just.
Yes. Oh, well, yes, yes. Now.
Does nobody else do that?
Not like a nine. Not like a nine.
We're gonna have to talk.
Nines
more.
Can go into well, especially if a nine's not having done some work, they can really become spacey, and people will perceive them sometimes as being spacey, or a little dissociated at times. You know, checking out. So it's like nines. I'm gonna tell you all about nines in a second, right? Eights have more energy on the Enneagram than any other number. Of all the numbers on the Enneagram, the one that has the least amount of stamina is nines. That doesn't mean they're lazy. It doesn't mean that they don't have a lot of energy. I'm just saying they're a very calm, easygoing, laid back presence in the world. When they get going on something, there's no stopping them. But they do suffer from inertia. If you stop them, it's hard to get them up and going again in the process. Oh, Jennifer's holding her back. You got any stories?
That's why I don't let her stop.
You can break in with a story anytime you want. But once you stop them, like when she goes off the road, I mean, when she works hard on the road, she doesn't stop, right?
Harder than anybody, yeah.
When she stops, how hard is it to get it back going again?
Yeah, it takes...
Jennifer's thinking, do I want to tell the truth or do I want to keep my job? Do I want to tell the truth?
No. But I think of it as just that I put my energy elsewhere.
You're never not doing something.
I don't stick in the middle zone. Mm-mm. But I do. I had a flashback of being a kid and mm-hmm. my next door neighbor, like being called a space cadet when I was a kid. I haven't thought about that in ages.
Yeah.
But like... she would lose her head if I wasn't screwed onto her body.
Well, it's because sometimes y'all wander off in your head. Uh-huh. Like, and your communication style for a nine is called what we call epic saga. So sometimes you'll start a story and it'll just keep going. And sometimes you'll start a line of conversation and other people, like a three, this would drive you crazy, Jennifer, because you are right to the point. Like, we have got stuff to do. Get to the point. And you may start and the story goes like this, or the line of reason goes like that.
Right.
You know what I mean? Uh-huh. And it takes a lot of detours before sometimes a nine will get to the point.
Yes.
Right? Versus a one or a five or different numbers where it's like, boom, bang, let's get this communication across. Right. So there is a quality, let me put it this way. You don't have laser-like attention. You would have diffuse attention. And meaning your attention would go out in every direction, which is kind of why you like nature. You see interconnectedness in everything. You see how things connect spiritually, cosmically. You know what I mean? It's like in a way that threes don't or sevens don't. Like your attention... takes in everything, okay? Whereas, Jennifer, your attention would be much more laser-focused.
That's why she needs me.
Exactly. No, this is exactly right. Yeah. And by the way, this is what makes, I've said this to Anthony before, that all the best songwriters I know are nines. Mm. And the reason is that you all, more than any other type, remember, you're perched at the very top of the Enneagram, which means that you kind of have an unobstructed view of the whole landscape. Versus every other type. And nines are known for being able to see the world through the lens of every type on the Enneagram, which is the reason you're called the mediators or the peacemakers. It's like you can find the middle ground anywhere. You can bring opposing sides that don't even look like they could possibly be reconciled and bring them to the middle and make it work out the peace pact.
My husband will say if there's a conflict somewhere, but especially if it's something that he's come up against, I'll take a breath like I'm going to say something, and he'll go, "Don't pull for the underdog."
Oh.
And I'll go, yep. I'm not pulling. I'm not pulling. I'm just like bringing to light a different perspective.
You will always be able to do that. You will always be able to bring the perspective of every other person in the room. And you actually deeply care about the perspectives. You want to include everybody in the room in the conversation, right?
Yeah.
So, Jennifer, I have a question for you.
Yes.
What is it in your relationship with Amy, 30 years, right? What do you wish that she knew and believed about herself that she doesn't?
You've been so affirming to me for
30 years.
30 years, yeah.
Well, but it's all true. She, talking about the underdog and how she roots for the underdog, I think a lot of times we've talked about that just with your writing and stuff, she will want to tell other people's stories. She does tell her own story on stage or whatever, but it's kind of because the moment calls for it, but... her stories, her inside, her experience. I, you know, sit on planes with her and drive and do whatever, and I hear it, but she's less likely to tell those on a grander scale. She lifts up other people's stories mm-hmm. more than her own. And that's one thing I would love to see
right.
change, because I think her life experience, her spiritual experience, the right. ups, the downs, all of that they're beautiful and they've been life-changing for me. So to hear about them and to witness them. So that's one thing.
Yeah, I think, but what do you think of that, Amy?
You don't have to agree.
Yeah, no, it's curious. Yeah.
Because even though you've had a platform and a voice in the world, a significant one, where anyone would say, well, gosh, you know, your presence really matters. Jennifer, it sounds like you're saying that you spend a lot of time lifting other people's up, or because you even said to me earlier today that you don't necessarily particularly want to be noticed or recognized in general, right? Just in general.
I love flying under the radar.
Yes, that's what you mm-hmm. said to me.
Yes. Yeah. But it's just an efficient use of energy. Mm-hmm. That's what it feels like, flying under the radar is, you know, you're not, you have energy for the experience of life. You have energy for the experience that you are either in or wanting to create or wanting to include, right. or even if it's solo. And to me, telling your story involves a certain amount of presentation.
Mm.
And I think that sometimes the presentation is not the reality. And right. why tell it if it's not the reality?
Right.
You know, so, I mean, to all that's kind of...
Yeah. Most nines I know are very, very real. Mm-hmm. Like, they are not... So, twos, threes, and fours are the most image-conscious numbers on the Enneagram. They tend to project images more than the other six mm-hmm. types. Nines, first of all, if I ever needed someone to lie for me in court, I would never ask my wife to do it. They are the nines are the worst liars in the world because they're pretty guileless in a lot of ways. Mm. And nines are what you see is what you get, people. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. They don't, you know, like I have to sometimes tell my wife, honey, can you go out and buy some clothes and wear some jewelry tonight? Because, you know, because it doesn't dawn on her.
Oh, my gosh.
Oh.
I have a friend, and I was starting to spend some time with Vince. This was years ago, and she came to me, and she said, I know you feel really pretty on the inside, but you could do with a little effort to the outside.
Right. Like, I have to, if I say to my wife, why don't you go to a spa for a day or something, treat yourself. Mm-mm. Would not yeah. even occur to her that I could do that. Yeah. Like, it, you know, it's not in her. She'd rather go for the walk. She'd rather go to the, you know, do something else. But it wouldn't occur to her. And I had to tell her, well, you know, you do matter enough to go do those things. And she goes, oh, I guess so. And, you know, but.
Yeah.
But if I went and did it, she would never object.
Right. This is where it's weird because there's nothing in me that thinks I don't matter.
Mm-hmm.
But can't that be the healthy part? Like, you've done enough work that you know you matter, but your sure. default, like when you travel or we go, so we've stayed in some fabulous places, but I've also traveled with people that we get there and they're like, all right, I'm getting a such and such at, you know, 10 a.m.
Right.
seaweed wrap. And you're much more, let's go take a walk. Let's go. Or
right.
you don't do that stuff. That's not what occurs to you to do with your time.
Yeah.
But it's not because I think you don't think you would deserve. You don't.
Yeah.
It's not that. It's just other things occur to you.
Yeah.
Not pampering.
Sometimes nines self-forget. Do you know what I mean? They just sort of self-forget in terms of investing in themselves. You know, they'll invest in lots of other people. They'll do that. But in terms of investing into themselves, they sort of sometimes have to be reminded of it. Like, take some time to do this for yourself, or, you know, take some time to read. It's like, it's not as natural to nines as other types to do that stuff.
That does not ring true to me.
Okay.
It rings true for me, for you.
Oh!
I'm so sorry, but it totally does.
Okay, why do you say that? And this is why it's awesome you're here, because actually having a dear friend when you're doing Enneagram work.
Right.
Is so helpful because we're not transparent to ourselves, right?
Yeah.
And
none
so
of
it's
us.
None of us. So it's like to have another person go, you know, kind of.
Right.
So what do you?
Well, I mean, you know, because we work together and we're dear friends, I see both sides of her life, and yep. and there'll be times where you'll say, "Hey, I want to, you know, let's take this time off the road to just be home and, whew, you know, cook dinner, do what have you." And so I do. We kind of retreat from the work world, but then, as an observer, I watch your life, and she says yes to this person and yes to that person and this and that. And the protective side wants to go, no, put boundaries up, do the thing you said right. you wanted to do.
Yes.
But it's not that you're not loving what you're doing, right. but the part of you that said, I need to just be home or right. not have things on my calendar doesn't tend to hold.
Yeah.
It ends up. And so there's times where I go, this is so interesting because right. I'm like going, no, really hold it.
Right.
I think it would be good. But then it's just it's.
Well,
but you're doing what you love to do.
Yeah. And to me, that feels very self-indulgent to me. So I exactly. don't feel like it feels like I am indulging that thing that I love to do. It's just not what I said I was going to do.
Mm-hmm.
So to me, time off is really just getting to, without a schedule, enjoy where the day takes me
okay.
or several days in a row
right.
or a week. And so it's not a matter of going, these are the things I want. But like, I love not having a schedule.
Yes.
I love yes. just going, sure.
Mm-hmm. So I'm going to come back in just a second with another a related question. Okay. So, but first I have to talk about this really great friend of mine who, Anthony, in fact, I spoke to this morning, Mr. Michael Cusick, our good friend, the founder and lead therapist over there at Restoring the Soul. He has really tapped into something brilliant.
Mm-hmm.
Michael knows that, you know, people can go to a 50-minute session every week, like I do.
Probably should go a little bit more.
You can go once a week to a therapy session, right? Mm-hmm. And you can get a lot out of it. But the problem is that sometimes we need more than that,
mm-hmm.
you know, particularly if you're on fire at the beginning of a journey, like something's really going on that needs a lot of immediate attention.
Right.
Right. In fact, I had this experience last week. I went to a 4-hour session last week.
Mm.
And the difference between like a longer session, like a half day session
yeah.
and a 1-hour session
yeah.
is astronomically greater if you have that longer time.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's more effort. It's more energy. It costs you more emotionally, but man, oh man, you just get more out of it. Michael does those kinds of intensives for 1 week or 2 week blocks of time.
Wow.
Half day sessions, you know, you do work in the afternoon. I mean, it's fantastic. And people come back over and over and over again to me saying, this was such a game changer. Like, I got more done. I got a year's worth of work done in 2 weeks,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
right? And it's pretty amazing, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing. Okay, so what does all this come down to? A lot of you out there listening are people who, you know, as I've been talking, are probably realizing that's the kind of work I need to do. You know, I've really got to invest myself in a process. And if you are that person, or know that person, I want you to go to restoringthesoul.com or call Mike and talk to him directly at 303-932-9777 just to investigate how a 1 week or 2 week intensive for yourself or for you and your partner could make an enormous difference in your lives. And if you are a Typology listener, you can get yourself a free PDF about how trauma may be affecting your relationships. So you said something earlier which I thought was really interesting. You said you, especially early in your career, obviously, you always put in situations where you had to adapt. But
I just assume that. Mm-hmm. I'm assuming I'm adapting because, well, I guess everybody has to do that with life.
Well, you were told where to go, mm-hmm. what time to be on stage, what time to be on the bus. I mean, you know what I mean? Like you were right. in situations, I would imagine, where...
Yeah. What I was mostly thinking is... and I wanted to be those places. Mm-hmm. I wanted to travel. I wanted to sing my songs. I loved being moved by music. Mm. And I loved being a part of creating music and providing music. But like, for instance, tonight you're meeting 100 people and then the show. And so going, right, whew, okay. Whew. So that kind of schedule, the meeting of 100 people that would happen, to me was like sort of an extraordinary experience of people. Mm. And so to me, whenever I say adapting, I mean, this feels atypical to the human experience. Mm-hmm. To meet 100 people that are each coming with very intentional conversation, and you feel a lot of energy coming from them. Mm-hmm. And so unless you're going to be rude, you receive that attention and you respond.
Right.
And so to me, that was an adaptation. I don't know if I had that skill set or not as a child, but I got it real fast.
Yeah.
And so whatever spaciness, you know, right. there wasn't room for that. Right. So that to me was an adaptation. And another thing would be, we would like for you to come participate in our event.
Right.
And so then you land, but the landing, when you're a part of somebody else's agenda, and you are what people have paid, you're the paid part of the agenda.
Right, yeah.
It's like you have landed, however gracefully or stealthily or whatever, but you're in an unfamiliar landscape, and so you're trying to figure out the dynamics of the people there, what's their agenda, what they want you to do, and then you deliver.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever that is.
Mm-hmm.
And that, all of that is thrilling to me.
Mm-hmm. And very natural to a nine.
Yes. And also, I was a host of a TV show. And my favorite thing was the producer would say, okay, we've got these four stories, these ongoing stories. You need to pull them all together. And it's going to be at such and such event. And it needs to be done in 3.5 minutes.
Mm.
And I mean, that was like the happy dance to me.
Really?
Yes, no script, hallelujah. How fast? Now, who is it? Okay. And if we can wrap it up in a song, even better. That's like, I need you to make soup. I'm not sure what leftovers are in the refrigerator, but there's at least garlic and onions and a few starches and lots of bouillon. And it was like, nothing was better because I didn't even know what it was going to be. It was just going to be something.
Right. It's all like that sort of from the gut thing, you know, it's like sort of responding to life with that. It's beautiful.
That, yeah, okay, gut, you're right.
So let me ask just a couple more questions. So we're 58, both 58.
Yes.
And so we've been around, you know, we've been around the block.
Oh, yeah.
Just in terms of life, suffering,
yeah.
Seen some stuff. How have you historically dealt with anger? And I mean anger,
mm-hmm.
disappointment, rage. Let's even, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
Just tell me what your relationship to anger has been like in your life.
I think that because my parents were both very reserved, I think I probably stuffed a lot of, I didn't have role models for expressing anger.
Mm.
And so probably... In hindsight, I would say that I experienced some ongoing and fairly like low-grade depression,
mm-hmm.
really from my late teens on. And I really think it was just not knowing how to process disappointment or something, or even anger. You know, I went through a divorce and we weren't really screamers, but... I think as I got older, I realized how important it was to be able to just, like, I love when no one's in the house and I might just have pent up something and to just scream, just feel so good. Just like, scream and then think, I think neighbors can hear this. So then going into a closet and screaming. And then it just, whew, that feels good.
Mm. Yeah. So anger, you know, that 8-9-1s, they're called the gut triad sometimes, but they're also called the anger triad. Because eights, like when you're around an eight, you can feel the anger radiating off them, and it all externalizes out. It all goes out from them.
Okay.
Okay, you can, like, you feel this energy, really, I mean, physically almost pouring out. Ones, the anger goes inward, and it, what they experience it as is, you'll hear that critical inner voice, and it gets directed inward, anger, right? For nines, anger goes to sleep. They're a little out of touch with their anger, which is why sometimes they don't have enough stamina, is because the good side of anger, that gives you that thing, can make them a little less energetic, right, than other people who are more in touch. So if eights are plugged into that 240-volt like thing behind your dryer, and everybody else is at 120, regular plug, sometimes nines are sort of at 100. You know what I mean? Or they don't, they kind of hum on a lower level. But nines tend to be a sleeper, like unaware of their anger. And yet they are as angry as eights. But typically it comes out passive aggressively. So how does how does that resonate with you, what I just said? Like how anger comes out sideways sometimes with a nine, like with stubbornness or...
Yes.
Is that a
stubbornness? Yes. And I think maybe in I just think my younger self, it would come out more in detachment.
Yes.
But that is, there's just less, the more responsibility you have, that doesn't, you don't want to be detached.
Mm-hmm.
But I would say, and I think my anger came out as distrust.
Mm.
When you say, I don't even know how, like stubbornness. Well, yeah, I mean, I'm positive I'm stubborn.
But quietly stubborn. Like sometimes the way that the anger comes out passive aggressively is instead of saying, oh, Jennifer, I'm really mad about this. It may be more like Jennifer may say, well, will you do this, that, and the next thing? And you'll be looking at her and you won't disagree. You won't even look like necessarily like you're agreeing or disagreeing. You're just... And she's going to think you're agreeing. Yes, I will do those things. But you have no intention of doing those things. And you know, you may sometimes feel like you're tapping the brakes a little bit, you know, on things that you just don't want to do. But you may not go into the fight because you want to avoid conflict in as much as is possible.
Yeah. Some things you've said and I've gone, yes, yes, yes. That doesn't, that doesn't resonate with me.
Uh-huh. Okay.
So I don't know.
I think we had to, one of the things I think in our working relationship and friendship that I felt was really healthy for her, which ended up being really healthy for me, is when she finally, you know, because there were other managers prior to me. I was a part of the team for the first 10 years and, you know, pretty much doing it for the last 20, but there was this youthful willingness, and I think you said earlier, from the time you were a teenager, you were part of someone's fiscal year, like the main part of their fiscal year. There was no saying no without it having a lot of dominoes to fall.
Mm-hmm.
And so I, more of an observer back then, I think there was a part of you that you're not resentful. There was just a part of you that would reframe things. That's the one of the things you've said, that be like, okay, well, wasn't maybe how I was planning to spend the whole spring, but yeah, no, I'll get on a bus. Here we go, you know. And she would reframe it for the positive, and you would find ways to make it like, oh, this is awesome, let's go. But over time, I felt like in our working relationship, when you would say no to something, if I came to it thinking, no, she needs to say yes to this. This is like a really good opportunity. We would get into a thing where I would try to, I guess, probably guilt her into doing it or convince her. And we talked about shame. Like I would try to shame her into doing it. And I remember the very first time you pushed back on that and it was a really awkward conversation, but it has been life-changing for
yes.
me because it made me see, oh my gosh, I do that. Like I in a lot of relationships, I have a certain level of power or something that can get people
sure.
to do what I want them to do. Mm-hmm. And when she pushed back against that, and being how important she is to me and how much I respect her, it was like, first, it was so hard to hear. I mean, it was like, what? No, I don't. But it was like always, yes, you do, to myself. But I feel like we worked through that. Mm-hmm. And now, I don't know, I don't feel, even when a work thing might go crazy, you'll say how you feel. Or we talk about a schedule and she'll say, like, I don't want to be home this year. I've got two girls getting married and Karina's graduating and mm-hmm. she's...
And that's age, too.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I think we've kind of... Yeah.
Well, and also, when you talk about passive-aggressive, I don't think I'm that.
Well, don't take that necessarily in the complete negative sense of the word. In other words, because nines aren't as tapped into that anger thing, sometimes, it just comes out less aggressively. And stubbornness is a big one for them. I mean, honestly, I know I've already said it, but it's like you'll tell a nine, the nine will give you a look like they're agreeing with you to do something, but there's a certain level of resistance inside that doesn't get expressed, you know, like, I really don't want to do that. And I might make it very difficult to get this car up a hill. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. What you ought to do is just think on it. Because seriously, sometimes it takes more contemplation and pondering to go, because I've had things about fours. I mean, like 2 weeks later, oh my gosh, I totally do that.
Yeah.
But it takes a while for it to kind of sink in for me.
Yeah.
We gotta wrap this thing up. But, you know, we've had breakfast since 9 o'clock. This has been the most wonderful day I've had since 9 until 2 o'clock with you today. It's been fantastic. Let's do it again. You got a song for us?
I can. Yeah.
Here All right.
So
let's bring it.
I'll get a guitar and then I'll figure out what I'm going to play.
Let's have it. What song are you going to play?
Somewhere Down the Road.
Oh, I love that song.
So much pain and no good reason why. You've cried till the tears run dry. Oh, and nothing here can make you understand. The one thing you held so dear is slipping from your hands. And you say, why does it go this way? And why all I can say is somewhere down the road there'll be answers to the questions. And somewhere down the road, though we cannot see it now, somewhere down the road you will find mighty arms reaching for you. Oh, and they will hold the answers at the end of the road. Well, yesterday I thought I'd seen it all. I thought I'd climbed the highest wall. Oh, but now I see the learning never ends. And all I know to do is keep on walking, walking round the bend, saying, why does it go this way? And why and all I can say is somewhere down the road there'll be answers to the questions. And somewhere down the road, though we cannot see it now. Somewhere down the road you will find mighty arms reaching for you. Oh, and they will hold the answers at the end of the road. Yeah, they will hold the answers at the end of this road. Gotta keep on walking. Somewhere down this lonely road, sung by a nine.
Amy Grant, thank you so much for gracing our studio today. And Jennifer, for joining, your pal. And man, what a treat. What a treat. I got to have breakfast through lunch today with you. And love me them nines. Love me them nines. Typology listeners, once again, thank you so much for your kindness, your listening. All 400,000 of you who are out there, we're delighted that you're part of our family. And remember, each and every one of you, be yourself. Everybody else is already taken.